We'll continue now with our next speaker, who is Maarten Molenaars from Recalled Old Coopers Group from Amsterdam.
Hi, can you hear me?
Hi, Maarten. Yeah, we can hear you very well.
Great.
So if you're ready, yeah.
So can you see my slide?
Yes, we can see it.
Perfect, okay. Yeah, thank you so much for this opportunity to present this project here today, which is, which is about a balance between mitochondrial translation and cytosolic translation, and this links to longevity pathways. So I always like to start with emphasizing that for your translation of your mRNA into a protein, you need both the large and the small subunits of the ribosome, and the biogenesis of these proteins, ribosomal proteins, together with translation, it takes up to 50% of all the energy in the cell. And what many reports have shown is that if you slow down translation, it extends lifespan in model organisms. And you can compare it a bit with the flame that burns twice as bright burns half as long. So for instance, a knockdown of these ribosomal proteins together with other processes is involved in longevity. So besides these ribosomes in the cytosol, you also have distinct ribosomes in the mitochondria, and they are dedicated to translating the mitochondrial DNA. And it has also been shown that if you slow down mitochondrial translation, that it can extend lifespan. For instance, here in C. elegans, if you knock down one of the mitochondrial ribosomal proteins, S5, it extends lifespan. So therefore, we hypothesize there might be unexplored regulatory links between these two translation machineries. For instance, there could be less energy, or there could be other types of communication. And this communication would make sense since you have the OXPHOS complexes and they are both dependent on nuclear encoded proteins and mitochondrial encoded proteins. So the first thing we did is we looked in VXD mice, and which are all different strains with slightly different genetic backgrounds, similar to us humans. And this plot, all these individual points are different mice strains. And then we found a correlation between all the mitochondrial ribosomal proteins and the cytosolic ribosomal proteins. So there seems to be this balance. And the next thing we wanted to know is that if you actively inhibit the mitoribosome, for instance, in C. elegans, what happens then to the cytosolic ribosome? We explored this by doing polysome profiles, where you can distinguish between monosomes and polysomes. Monosomes are mRNAs with only one ribosome attached, while polysomes have more, and these are highly translated. So you can put your lysate on a sucrose gradient, and then you can distinguish between the small subunit, the large subunit, the big peak is always the monosomal peak, and then you have the polysomal peaks with each time one more ribosome. So this is what the control worms look like. Then if we look at, if you inhibit mitochondrial translation, also cytosolic translation is affected, where there is a reduction in the polysomal peaks and an increase in the monosome, suggesting that there are more mRNAs with only one ribosome attached. Then the next thing we wanted to know, which RNAs are then highly translated or not. So we did RNA sequencing, and then we found the GO terms associated with low translational efficiency were translation and ribosome biogenesis. So when looking at all the individual cytosolic ribosomal proteins, almost all of them have a reduced translational efficiency. So, and then we wanted to know how is this translational balance, how can this be regulated? And we were interested in ATF5 as a candidate because, which is ATF5 in worms, because it was shown that it is a key regulator of the mitochondrial stress response. And also, if you overexpress this transcription factor in yeast, then we found similar changes in the polysome profiles. And indeed, the reduced polysomal peaks in MRPS5 RNA, they are rescued when you also knock down ATF5. And also the lifespan extension was dependent on HDF5, as you can see here, it's reduced. So the next thing we wanted to see if this is also conserved in mammalian cells, and if you inhibit mitochondrial translation pharmacologically. And you can do that with the antibiotic doxycycline, which besides targeting the ribosomes in the bacteria, it also targets specifically the mitoribosome. And also it was shown that doxycycline treatment also can extend lifespan. So we gave human K562 cells a treatment with either DMSO, amoxicillin, which is a control antibiotic we used that doesn't target mitochondrial translation, and of course doxycycline. And while amoxicillin does not change the polysome profiles, doxycycline treatment did, where you can see again a reduction of the polysomal peaks. Moreover, we found also that ATF4 was upregulated in the doxycycline treated cells. Then the last thing we did is to look in vivo in mice. So we gave germ-free mice a treatment with either amoxicillin as a control, or a low dose of doxycycline or a high dose. And looking at the liver, the polysome profile showed that there is a dose-dependent response also of doxycycline on cytosolic translation. Then when looking again at the polysomal RNA specifically, so the highly translated RNA, we found in these mice that the most downregulated GoTerm was translation. And again, almost all of the cytosolic ribosomal proteins were reduced. That led us to the conclusion that we found a mitocytosolic translational balance in worms, human cells, and mice, where if you inhibit either genetically or pharmacologically the mitoribosome, also the cytosolic ribosome is affected, which goes via ATF4. And we published this work this year. So if you are interested in a lot more details, then please go to this paper. And these are all the people involved, and especially my supervisors, Rico Houtkoper, Alison McInnes, and George Johnsons. Thank you for your attention, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Perfect, thanks, Marte. So we have one question from Wilbert Vermey. Is it mainly ATP usage or also other energy sources that are required for translation?
So, yeah, that's a very good question. But we actually did not find any changes in ATP in the MRPS5 treated worms. So it seems that instead of slowing down, they rewire their metabolism and they use the energy that is saved by the cytosolic translation for other processes, we think.
Okay, and another question from Morten. Great talk, Marte. Loss of translation can lead to diamond black fin anemia or Treacher-Collins syndrome. How do we get to the sweet spot in humans?
Yeah, so you definitely don't want any mutation in these ribosomal proteins. Also in mutants, we see if we have a knockout of one of these ribosomal proteins, they are not viable. So we really want to slow it down and not totally shut down the translation. Yeah.
Okay, interesting. So there are still, I can see there are still people typing on Slack, so you can also just go online on Slack to answer the other questions. But thanks for joining us.